Something interesting came up when he was talking about Uber and Ola. When do you think the first hailing service, taxi hailing service, actually started? Any guesses? We all know Uber and Ola, which are the taxi hailing services which are there. Any guesses when it started? Any guess? Random? No? 4 years back. 2014. Okay. 2011. Interestingly, this started way back. This was started by a guy called Friedrich Rainer in 1897, when the actual hailing service started, right? Now, the reason you remember all this is because technology actually changed the way we look at taxi services today. It's totally changed. That's exactly what we are talking about, transformation, right? You're seeing a big transformation happening here. It was also interesting when my good friend Shashi there spoke about self-healing data centers, right? Just on a lighter note, we come from a cloud services platform. You don't need data centers. So we will self-heal everything for you, right? That's on a lighter note, Shashi. The point is, our vision basically when we started this company was to create lifetime relationships with customers. I think it's very important when we start doing business that we have a long-standing relationship and we actually deliver world-class hybrid IT services. So I just want to give a brief as to what our company is, ESDS. We are actually present across the world with multiple data centers. We have 2 million websites which we actually host today with close to about 38,000 plus customers and being in this business for about 14 years. We have our services in US and UK, apart from India, right? We have close to about 500 plus customers who use some of these technologies which I'll be talking to you about. We have various customers in SAP, SAP HANA, which is a big practice which we actually run for our customers. Government again is a very big business. We host close to about 280 plus banks which are hosted with us. And there's a reason why we will share as to why many of our customers are today hosting most of their critical services across with ESDS, right? Like I mentioned, we have our data centers in Nasik, Mumbai, and Bangalore. All three are tier three data centers with all the relevant certifications which are critical for us to run data center services. Metis, for example, has guidelines in terms of what are the relevant certifications you need to have to run a data center. For you to host banking, you have those relevant certification security parameters you need to follow to run those data centers. So we have all of those which are relevant for us to run these services. We were also considered as a great company to work for. We were ranked 8th as far as a company to work for is concerned. Now let's look at what we all know. Spoke about a lot about hybrid IT. How many of you use public cloud in this room? Show of hands, roughly. Okay. So we all know that when we speak about public cloud, you will talk about scalability, right? Standard why people use public cloud today, very scalable. We talk about flexibility, which today public cloud offers to customers in terms of the way you actually run your businesses, very flexible. Availability obviously is a very big thing when it comes to running public cloud services. And of course, the cost advantage. CapEx versus OpEx, we just heard about that. So you have a lot of cost advantages. Now, I saw a lot of people who didn't raise hands. So my obvious guess is you are in some form a private cloud, right? And why would you do that? You would probably do that because you want your services, what you're running, isolated. You want your own networks, which is there. You would want a better data security, that you believe that data security is critical, so you would host all this within your data centers, which are there. You would obviously look at ease of customization, lying with your premises, lying in your data center, very easy for you to do things, which is what you believe that you need to do. And last but not the least, you believe that you have a better control at a granular level. It's always happens that when you are in control of something, you believe it's very comfortable, right? So these are largely the reasons why you would start using a private cloud. But if you actually look at it, when you look at, let's say, optimizing versus innovating in infrastructures, right? Is it one against the other? You can never do that. You actually need both of these when you look at any infrastructures. You need to optimize your infrastructures. There is no doubt about it. At the same time, you need to innovate as far as your business needs are concerned. Correct? Now, let's look at innovation. Is sustaining good enough in innovation? Not possible. We've seen some of the companies who have shut businesses because they could not be disruptive in nature. They were innovative. They sustained to a point, but if you don't disrupt some of these, you're not going to survive. Let's look at business models. Does your business models, existing business models, good enough today? No, it's not. You would create new business models, but does not mean that you're going to write off your existing models. You will start with new business models, but your existing models will continue to be there, right? Lastly, let's look at processes. You would have existing processes. Nobody is going to kind of push all your processes below the carpet, what is existing. You would continue with those processes by optimizing it, but you will always look at reinventing new things within your processes. Now, this is largely how you would do within your organization in every aspect of what you run your businesses, right? Now, when somebody says cloud, it does not mean cloud only. You know, this is something which I keep hearing in the market. I come from an infrastructure background, and when I was in infrastructure background, we used to keep hearing this, cloud only. But is it really cloud only, right? Second, it also does not mean only public cloud. Today, we keep hearing multiple players saying, move everything to public cloud. Please host it there. Solves all your problems. No, it actually doesn't. It does not solve all your problems by hosting everything on a public cloud. Neither does it solve your problems by hosting everything only on a private cloud, right? So it is not necessarily only public cloud. We spoke about this. Public cloud gave you these advantages. And an on-prem deployment when you do it in a private cloud gave you these advantages, right? We all agreed. Now let's look at it. Why are we discussing this aspect? Now, when we are traveling to a different station, you're traveling somewhere, you have your own car when you're in Hyderabad. Let's assume you're going to Bangalore. Are you going to buy a new car? You won't. You're going to use existing services available in that particular place, but you're not going to buy a new car just because you traveled there. Right? It's the same thing. When you're traveling, you're not going to buy a new house just because you went to Bangalore for some days. Correct? You're going to kind of use a hotel to stay there. Same thing when it comes to, let's say, debt versus equity. It's not one against the other. You have to understand that when it comes to all of these clouds, it's never one against the other. There is always this conversation which keeps happening, which is better. It is not one versus the other. How do you take benefits of these? We all saw this, and I spoke to you that it is not just about the public cloud. Neither is it just about the private cloud, because you have traditional infrastructures which you are, there are customers who are using traditional infrastructures today. So it is not, again, one versus the other. You all spoke about somebody having private clouds or traditional IT and some hosting on public clouds. There are customers today who do both of these, right? But let's look at the economics of this. Now, there's always this saying that public cloud is very cheap. Go host it. No, it's actually not. Neither is private cloud, right? Where does the scale come in? You actually start saving money when you're actually using both. When there is, you're managing both your infrastructures effectively, is when you actually start saving money. It is not by saying, I will do only this or I will do only that. It is not one versus the other. It is always one with the other. So you have to start looking at this in terms of your economics as to how does it work when it comes to public versus private. That's where the whole concept of hybrid cloud comes into play for our customers, right? Now we said, what is hybrid? You have private clouds where you just spoke about, you have different hypervisors which you are running within your infrastructures. Then you have the traditional IT. These are largely what constitutes a private cloud, right, within your data center. Then you have the public cloud services. You have Amazon, Google, Azure. You have all of these guys who give you public cloud services, right? Now let's look at what is the basic need. you basically need to monitor, right? You need to monitor all your infrastructure. We spoke about what HP said about monitoring a whole infrastructure on hybrid IT. You need to manage this, right? And of course, you need to control it. We spoke about control. Why are people having it within their data center? They want control, right? Now, that's where we believe we come in. We launched the eNlight 360, which is basically a new age data center. And we will share a little bit, and I'll start talking a little bit about what exactly does eNlight 360 do from a hybrid cloud perspective, right? Let's look at what eNlight 360 does. eNlight 360 is a product which basically offers a hybrid cloud platform to customers. It is a software-defined data center in a way which can run on any x86 platform. It can run on any storages. You can have any storage within your infrastructure, any IP networks. What is interesting within this is you will get what all you have on a public cloud in the same form you can get it within your premise and on a hybrid platform also. So what does it mean? There are scaling which all cloud does in some form. We call it auto scaling, right? You will interestingly find that across the globe, everybody does what we call as horizontal auto scaling, right? How many of you use cloud? You would be knowing this, that you would typically add more compute resources, put a load balancer, and keep scaling, right? That's largely how you do scaling, which is horizontal auto scaling. What we do is we give an option of vertical auto scaling, and I'll share as to what the benefits are. We are also the company which gives you a paper consumption model, right? You basically pay for what you consume, not what you use, and there's a difference. And of course, we'll discuss a little bit more detail about hypervisor support and how it manages data center and all of these, right? We will discuss a little bit more. Now, I want to give you a brief. When you buy a cloud, and this is for people who have cloud or people even in a private cloud, you would typically have instances which you buy which are in the capacity and the multiples of what you just see here. It's always multiples, fixed multiples of what these instances are, correct? Now, these are predefined. You can't change it. You agree? All these are predefined. There are instances which you buy. These are predefined instances which you actually do. What's the challenge of this? This is what I mentioned about these are horizontal scaling. So when you want to add more instances, you want more compute, you scale it horizontally by adding more capacity. Like I mentioned, you add a load balancer, you put more capacity. What is the challenge of an infrastructure like this, right? Legacy applications actually can't take advantage of this. And a classic example is banks. Today, newer banks are doing this, but take some of the older banks. For example, you would not find Finacle hosted on a cloud. It's not. There are a lot of legacy applications which cannot take the benefit of the scaling platforms which are there. Second, like I mentioned across to you, these are charged for a fixed size. So you pay for what you actually, the size is fixed, and you pay for it, right? So it's pay-per-use, basically. There is a decreased efficiency, and I'll tell you why there is a decreased efficiency in your infrastructure when you run a horizontal scaling platform, correct? Now, what are we doing? We said, instead of doing a horizontal scaling, we will give the benefit to a customer where we will scale vertically. So what does it do? Your virtual server actually starts scaling by itself. Now, this is a patented technology by ESDS. So this scales vertically, and it can scale to the extent of what your usage is required at that point of time and scale back when the usage is not required, right? Now, this is a very, very different platform in comparison to what is available today in any technology as far as scaling is concerned. This is the pure vertical scaling. And let me give an example of how it scales. Now, typically, when you have a server, which is about 4 GB, you put a threshold. This is standard. Everybody puts a threshold saying it's 65%. Compute goes to 65, stops there, correct? Post that, what do? You add, right? Once it goes to 66%, you're going to add another server, correct? Once you add that server, you put a load balancer, and what happens? Right? We all agree this is how it gets done. Now let's look at what we do on eNlight. This particular server remains the same. What it starts doing is you start seeing a lot of unused space when you have a scaling like this. You have unused capacity. See the capacity difference when you scale vertically. Your unutilized capacity reduces to that extent when you are actually doing a vertical scaling vis-a-vis a horizontal scaling. Now, this is with just one server, one capacity which we are talking about. Now, let's look at what happens if you actually have multiple servers. Now, think about the unutilized capacity which is actually lying in your data centers today because of this. And think about what happens when you actually start using eNlight. We spoke about energy efficiency, and this is where it starts coming in. Not to mention cost structures. Not to mention a lot of benefits, which we'll also talk about, right? But this is the most biggest difference which we bring to the industry today. This is patented to us. We have a US and UK patent for this specific technology, what we call as the vertical scaling. And this basically helps us do a pay-per-consume model, right? Now, what does it do? Typically, when you have those resources, you actually pay for all the resources which you bought. Has anybody charged you at a 3.62 GB? No, it never happens. It's always multiples, right? You never got charged for 3.62. What happens with us? Let's assume you're only consuming certain aspect of it. You bought 4 GB. But let's assume for a minute that you actually consumed only 3.62 GB. You are actually going to be charged for the resources which are allocated, not for what you bought. And you will have basically a billing cycle which will show you exactly the same. So we've done this and brought this down to the extent of every 5-minute billing cycle. Because there are customers, e-commerce companies whose cycle changes are very different, right? This gives you a benefit of cost management when you start looking at things in a very different way in any infrastructure. Not necessarily, I'm not talking this from a public cloud perspective. This could be even private cloud also, right? Now, that's an example of one of the customer who actually had substantial amount of saving, which runs with us, right? Now, the benefit is simple. You don't need sizing of virtual machines. This happens real time. The capacity is sensed automatically and designed to scale real time. So you don't need to worry about it. Virtualization alone reduces IT costs, but this does even better. And I showed you how the capacity utilization is taken advantage by using this technology. Of course, you will have licensing costs going down. There is no doubt about it, because the number of servers, number of compute which you're adding is that much more lesser. Better utilization and reutilization of existing hardware. Typically, what happens is today you have hardware which is 5 years old. What do? You throw it away. You say you're going to kind of refresh it. You don't need to refresh it. With platforms like this, you don't need to go for a refresh. I'm sorry if my HP friends are here, but you don't need to do that, right? Improved server consolidation ratio. You're talking of what used to be is 10:1 to 15:1. And lastly, of course, local database access with the lowest latency. Most of your database need local access. Hence, your latency is much better. Basically, it improves in-memory compute, right? Now, I'll run through quickly some of the features which probably would be of interest to you. It also does auto discovery of all physical entities. You can put an IP range, starts discovering everything. It also does discovery of all virtual entities, not just the hardware, but it also does all virtual entities discovery within your organization infrastructure, which is there. So you don't need to, you know, kind of import everything and start trying to figure out how do I start setting up things, right? It also gives you a resource summary. This is when you set up within your premise, or when you have a hybrid, it will still give you a resource summary, which is at every level, and we'll show you a little bit more detail on this, right? It of course helps you doing a private to public cloud burst. This largely comes in handy when we've seen it with a lot of e-commerce players where they suddenly need compute resources and they want to kind of manage for people who are having private clouds, want to burst it into public clouds, right? So this will help you basically do that as far as bursting traffic into your public cloud platform, right? Let's skip this. It gives you a multi-hypervisor support. All possible hypervisors you can think of is support for this. It also has different OS support. So you don't need to worry that it is going to support only X platform as far as the support is concerned. It does intercompute VM migration. Now this is very important again. When you are trying to migrate, most of the large customers today have multiple hypervisors and they struggle to do some of these migration which is there. So with this, you will be able to do intercompute migrations across different neutral storage as far as the storage is neutral, right? This is able to do it from whichever platform. It does VM lifecycle management, remove the VMs, it stops VMs, quota management, it does all of these. These are standards we could discuss a lot more when we are outside, but it does a full-fledged VM lifecycle management, compute storage, and network, right? It also takes snapshots. This is a part and parcel of what this particular product offers. And it is template management, so you can create your own templates when you are setting up most of these cloud infrastructures within your premises. It also does quota management, identity management, and of course has job schedulers when you have these VMs need to be scheduled. We'll run through this fast because there's a lot of slides and I don't want to take away some of the time, but it does policy-based VM deployments. You can select the zone, select the policy. All of these stuff are a part and parcel of what we offer as a part of the eNlight 360. It does multi-tenancy, and this is very important because you have different, you know, companies within companies today, right? And you have different, you know, you have finance, you have R&D, all these groups who actually use your infrastructure today. How do you manage these better? This will help you basically do a multi-tenancy. You can set roles, you can define quotas, you can do all of those stuff with basically the whole eNlight 360 platform which is there. You can give access control, you could decide whom to give, not to give. These are standards which are again available as a part of this. You can define ownership, you can define user groups. This is the dashboard it will come up with. It gives you power utilization, space utilization, it gives you device reports, profile alerts, syslog monitoring. It covers what is required to run your full-fledged IT infrastructure. It gives you device counts. This is required sometimes because the challenge today in most of the infrastructures is because you have different set of hardware, different set of softwares, different set of protocols which run applications which run within your infrastructure today. The challenge for every IT person is how do I manage all of these things? There is no one tool typically today, right? There is, you know, Dell who says, these are my tools which I'll give you. HP will tell, these are my tools which are there. Everybody gives a different tool. And if you want to buy something to manage something as complex as this, you have to pay a lot of money because there are tools available. Not that there are no tools available today in the market for this. But it's pretty complex, right? It also does the network heat map. It maps your whole network. It tells you where your network problems are. It manages IP traffic. So within your organization, if somebody is hogging IP within your organization and you're able to figure out which exactly is the IP address which is hogging all the traffic, you will be able to figure out all of those stuff with all the details, what is the RAM usage the guy is taking. So there's a lot of things which actually the whole eNlight 360 actually platform does. Like I mentioned, CPU usage, latencies, RAM usage, every single thing is available. It gives you a network topology dashboard. At any given point of time, start showing red. If your networks are down, which switch is down, which router is down, it actually starts showing you all of those details also. It gives you the detail of the switch, which branch. By the way, this is not specific where you need to put it only in one place. If you have different data centers, you can actually manage all of your data centers sitting at one place. You don't need to actually have people managing data centers in different locations. You can actually run this from a single location and manage it. We do it because we have data centers across the globe. We use this to manage our data centers today, very clearly, right? It also does server heat map. It will tell you exactly in terms of what is the utilization rates as far as the servers are concerned, what is the compute capacity it is running at. All these advantages, what you get out of these, what we're talking about, is all on a single dashboard. And I'll just share with you how the dashboard looks like, right? It's a rack stack device management. At a rack level, you will know exactly what is happening. This is not just at a server level. This is at a rack level. Different zones, different locations, all of these can be mapped across, and you will be able to figure out what exactly is happening, right? Storage management. It also does monitoring alerts for server, switch, firewall, which I just did discuss. We'll skip this. It does port monitoring, NetFlow, I just spoke to you about this. It also does database monitoring. These are the databases which we support as far as monitoring databases are concerned. Query performance, log shipping status. It does a lot of things from a database perspective also. And these are all with a single tool which we are talking about, right? Syslog, I'll skip this. It also does SIM. It does data collection, data analysis, and SIM output. This is, again, a part and parcel of the same tool which we are talking about. So usually you would see that SIM is a very different platform when it comes to managing as far as customers are concerned. This particular thing will actually help you as far as managing from a single tool which we are talking about. It also comes with a vulnerability scanner. This is a domain scanner only. Our largest customer, for example, is SBI for this, whose all their domains are scanned by this particular scanner. It does all of the scanning, which is mentioned on the right side of me. So this is a part and parcel of the eNlight 360 as a product which we actually offer, right? It also does a showback and a chargeback mechanism. This I mentioned across. There are organizations today who actually have chargeback mechanisms within their organizations. So this will again help you in terms of a chargeback mechanism if you have different business units within your organization, right? This is a simple dashboard which it will come up with. You will have all of these. We also have an IoT platform which is a part of this dashboard. So we have an IoT, eNlight IoT, which actually does IoT services for your for our customers. We also have multiple things like running. We have container services which are there. We have Hadoop services which are there. All these are from a single console only. You don't need to go anywhere else when you add. You just go click on this. You can start adding services at a click. That's how as simple it is, right? This is the dashboard, how the dashboard will look like when you get an access. We also have a lot of products and services. We run SAP Cloud. We run Government Community Cloud. We run Smart Cities Community Cloud. And the benefits of all of these largely when you look at community clouds are it gives the protocols and security what is relevant to those set of customers. So we bring in the expertise as far as what do customers specifically look for when it comes to SAP. We know it. So we run it all those customers in a specific community cloud only. So we have the banking and we have the public community cloud, right? Apart from that, of course, we also do a lot of remote management services. We do host management, application support. These are managed services which are there. We also have a lot more product portfolio which is there. We also do chatbots. We do bots which are voice bots, not just chat. There's a lot of portfolio which is there, but I'll not take too much time on this. Like I mentioned, these are the software products which are there. eNlight 360 is a product which I just spoke to you about, which helps you as far as the hybrid cloud platforms are concerned. MTV Scan is a product of it, which is the vulnerability scanner, which it is there, and eMagic. You can buy all of these separately also, by the way. If you want just a tool to manage your infrastructure, eMagic is a product for it. eNlight is the total product which gives you all of those things which I spoke to you about. These are largely our customers. You would find customers across everywhere in all different segments, manufacturing, banking, government, all of these. And SAP is, of course, which I mentioned, is one of the biggest practice for us, right? But thank you so much. I would be here. The only message I can give you is there is no one cloud. It is not about public and private. It is not public versus private. It is about a hybrid cloud. So we will be here to help you in whatever way you believe you need to transform your company, in whichever fashion it needs to be transformed, and we will be there available for you to help you out. Thank you so much.